Okay, this is Dialogue Conspiracy for another Saturday afternoon with Mae Brussell and her guest Paul Krassner. So why don't you just take it away immediately, Mae?
Paul, take it. It's all yours.
Chet. Well, it really feels good to be back on radio. I was on for 7 months in San Francisco and got fired after 7 months because I went to all pre-programmed music.
Oh.
And I was doing what's called free form, and which is what you do, except in a specialized area. But I think there's a relationship between why I got fired and the kind of thing you talk about on this show, which is that essentially the country is run by a conspiratorial shadow government. And I don't think people realize the insidious shrewdness that those people have and the levels to which they reach. And one of the things that I discovered in my own research was that Goebbels, who did is that the way it's pronounced?
Yeah. Oh, I call him by another name.
Oh, well, yeah.
I'll be off the air.
You know how the FCC is about real names.
Okay.
To protect the guilty. But Goebbels always sounds to me like those little hamsters that you have anyway. Anyway, Goebbels was a practicing Gurdjieffian, and people always think that, and Gurdjieff is a kind of spiritual teacher, and people always think that these people were just pure sadists, and yet Gurdjieff is represented a kind of game playing, but you can carry game playing on at a very amoral level, and this was what he did as Minister of Propaganda. And I think that there's a almost linear connection between control of the media and why I got fired and why they go into more and more pre-programmed music to get people into a certain rhythm.
To get away from talking things out.
To getting away from using your imagination.
Well, didn't you write up in The Realist about KLRB having the courage, to have this kind of a program? It's one of the few stations in the United States that would have a dialogue on facts and evidence that indicate conspiracy.
The only other ones I know are the listener-sponsored stations in the Pacifica Network.
And even they don't go that far. I've contacted them at different times. They go within a certain set limit of what they can talk about.
Yeah, it was on WBAI in New York when I interviewed you. They kept you on for 4 hours and then played it again.
That was, great.
But that was unusual.
They didn't ask for a weekly show, though, after that.
Oh, well, I'm sure they'd be willing to. Oh, yeah, we'll send them a copy of this tape.
Let's see how it goes. But I think it is a rare opportunity to be able to have a dialogue about evidence that you see in the newspaper or in books that you read or documentation with the archives that points to conspiracies and be able to share it with the people that are listening and give them the reference where they can look it up and talk about it.
Well, since this past week was the Democratic Convention, we thought together that we agreed that it might be interesting just to put that through the... See, there's a filter that I've discovered. People have different filters. And so any event, there was an event in today's news about John Kennedy Jr., and eight individuals in Greece, the Greek government said that they were arrested for an attempted conspiracy to kidnap John Kennedy Jr.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Now, you can start, if you're a conspiracy theorist, as you are, you might see that as, aha, this is a way of spreading the fear, especially when it comes out that they're now accusing some new left group of doing it.
Oh, because they've been called extremists and radicals, and
just
look what they'll do. Yeah.
Just to spread that paranoia.
Uh-huh.
There are probably, though, some really America firsters, ultra super conservative patriots who might see that as, the new lefters are doing it again. There are probably new lefters who are seeing it and say, there's subdivisions. Some of them say, oh, that's a good thing. We'll finally, we'll get some money for the cause that way. And others saying, it's a trap. So through the conspiracy filter, which you've built up over your 9 years of research, how what's happened in the past few days in Miami, how would it go through that filter?
Well, the Miami thing was completely altered by the Watergate arrest. That's been on my mind for 3 weeks. And the men that were arrested in Washington, D.C., the five men that were arrested at the Watergate Hotel, and the four who fled were so terribly important to the structure of the government and to the hiring of provocateurs and setting the stage for violence at the elections that it completely altered the climate of Miami. I think that the people that were there I kept saying for months before the conventions, if they just sat on their hands and didn't do anything and kept quiet, the only people making scenes with violence would be the provocateurs. But when you have the money man, like Mr. Barker, arrested and in jail with $89,000 of cash, you know, which is CIA $100 bills, and he is paying provocateurs in Miami, everybody's scared, afraid to be associated with them. They blow their cover, and if they're arrested and their finger, like, oh, you're a provocateur, what are they going to do? It changed the complete plans of the election scene for the Republican convention. It's going to change the Democratic convention. What happened at the Watergate Hotel is going to change the street scene terribly. I don't know if it'll change the long-range plans, but the actual physical assault or the beating, the television studios were very depressed because it was what they said, a dull occasion. And they had advertised, you know, Cronkite and the others will be on the radio a certain amount of hours, except if something comes in that's unforeseen. And they were hoping that there'd be all the clubbing and the scene in Chicago. They would get down to this good news coverage and maybe people killed and so forth. But there was just a minimum of that, an absolute minimum of it. And I feel that the arrests were so significant because the high level of them, that the word went down and they were really being watched in Miami and they were afraid to step forward. And because, for one thing, if they step forward and they're linked to the people that are arrested, it makes the case even tighter. You see, there was an article in the paper just today about the group from the veterans from Vietnam that were down in Miami, and they were going to provoke violence for the 1972 conventions for the Republicans. But they've been arrested on a conspiracy charge in Tallahassee, Florida. This group was going to cause riots at the Republican convention. And the paper said it was part of a conspiracy that the defense, the individual co-conspirators would organize numerous fire teams to attack with automatic weapons, fire and incendiary devices, police stations, police cars, and stores in Miami on various dates between August 21st and 24th. Well, they were listed and arrested for 15 overt acts. Well, these men were found this week for what they're going to do then, and the men that were hired for this election were not rioting because they'd be linked if they were paid for this. People don't go out and do this for nothing. They're paid for it. If any of the money was linked to the men that were arrested, you know, look what would happen to the case. It's tight enough as it is now. They're sitting with a hot potato. So I think the Miami thing was very calm, and I don't think a lot of people wanted it to be that calm. You see what happened when the hippies and all the young people, the music lovers got together at Woodstock. They had a phenomenon of masses of people making it together that even the establishment press couldn't get over. The lack of violence with mud and rain and uncomfortable conditions. So they followed it with a planned clandestine thing like the Aldemont to show and photograph to show that they're not all love and beauty. Well, the Republican convention was going to be blood and guts, but I think the Democratic was too. But with the arrest at the Watergate Hotel, maybe you can explain. I assume that everyone knows what we're talking about there. Maybe just give a little
background. The Watergate Hotel?
Yeah. Explain, because don't you think that was an important thing in the climate of the convention? Do you feel it was at
all? I think it's one aspect. See, I think there were several aspects.
Yeah.
One of the filters that I see it through is as a one of the original founders of Yippie.
Yes.
Abby Hoffman, Jerry Rubin, and I were, I suppose, the three original founders, whatever that means. All that means is that, in my case, particularly since I gave the name to it, I just gave a label to a phenomenon that already existed. In fact, that repression helped create as a
yes.
kind of political backlash. But I was disappointed in statements that Abby and Jerry had been making in Miami, promising that there would be no disruption of the Democratic convention, because the implication of that is that if anything happens at the Republican convention, they're responsible. Or if anything happened in 68 in Chicago, that they were responsible.
Well, it was
it's like an admission, but indirection.
Why did they say we'll be quiet at the Democratic convention, but we'll break loose at the Republican? Why did they make that statement?
I don't know. One of the other statements was, if you can only come to one convention, come to the Republican convention.
Why? Why were they going out for the Republicans?
Well, because the Democrats have been out of power for 4 years, and they said that there were progressive forces in it, and to the extent that McGovern did get nominated, I suppose that's progressive. I don't know about the... Well, I don't know about the vice president, because you talk about Spiro Agnew as being a deal in the case of Nixon's having him as a running mate in 68. Do you think that there's any kind of parallel with in the case of Tom Eagleton?
Well, I looked up as much as I could in the last few days his voting record or his opinion on certain domestic problems and the Vietnamese problem. And I felt that McGovern pretty well knew his background. They've been close friends, and their ideas are exactly parallel, you know, and that he didn't surface his name earlier. But I'm sure that Ted Kennedy and Eagleton were very close, too, and I'm sure that they meant to introduce a name if McGovern got the nomination. But if they mouthed it earlier, there'd be a lot of coming down on him, and people would be taken to look up in advance his position on Vietnam. A lot of the Wallace people and the Johnson Democrats and the Ohio people would all come down. So they had a good man in the wings, but they just didn't blow it by exposing the name earlier. They let all the other names be exhausted, and then they brought him in. But I don't think it was, I think it was a complete break with the old political deal, like John Kennedy backing away in 1960 and not taking a liberal partner with him and saying, real greedy, like, I need those Texas votes, therefore I'll take Lyndon, or the backroom deals, let's take the Pendergast, the machine. It wasn't that kind of a deal. It was put, you know, out where it should be, where people had a choice, which is much less of a deal than announcing, this is who I'm going to take. And I sent a letter to every single member of Congress and the Senate 2 years ago in 1970 on the problem of selecting the vice president of the United States, that it was outrageous that when a man gets nominated, that he automatically says, and that I want this man. And I've sent out letters since that time, since 1970, to public officials and spoken about it. I just think it's disgusting that it should be something on the floor where everyone has a choice. And I think you can't say there was a deal here to force people to take him.
Well, originally he said he was going to leave it open to the convention, but by giving his choice, that's like a Jewish mother saying, okay, you can go to college or you don't have to. It's up to you. I don't care.
But never see me again.
Right.
But don't come home, and if I die of a heart attack next year, don't come to my funeral. Put the whole story
in. Or if you come to my funeral, get a haircut.
Yeah, we get a haircut.
But anyway, you said before, because you just mentioned something, which is the tip of the iceberg of your research, and you said, did people make that association? And you were talking about the Watergate conspiracy in relationship to the Democratic Convention. Let me just refer to a couple of clippings I have, and just to bring that up to date. One of them is, this was from the Washington Post, and the headline, and headline writers are another breed.
Yeah.
The headline is, Martha Mitchell Happy Now. if you read it, she's saying inside, I'm still a political prisoner.
But she's a happy one.
She said, I can't talk long. I am calling surreptitiously, right? A happy act to call on a sneak.
Yeah.
When pressed as to whether Mitchell's resignation as President Nixon's reelection campaign director had made her happy, she said, quote, sure, that's what I wanted. But in the next paragraph, it says, Mrs. Mitchell said she was calling from her home in Washington's exclusive Watergate apartments. She also said she wondered why no one had asked a question about her at President Nixon's news conference last week, adding, quote, I've been a prisoner for so long, but a happy one.
Right?
Then Mrs. Mitchell hung up the telephone abruptly, right? Happily, but abruptly.
The headline says she's happy now.
Yeah.
She sneaks the phone, and she's still a prisoner, but she's a happy.
Then the other one is...
Do you think the visit of the Army psychiatrist, so many times in Rye, New York, could make her happy? Do you think any medication there made her happy?
Well, sure, the way... there's drugs now which can affect your memory with hypnotism.
Yeah.
And that's like asking somebody who has had a prefrontal lobotomy if they're happy, you know.
She can't talk long on the phone, but she's happy.
Yeah, well, she didn't use the word happy. The question was put, did the resignation of her husband make her happy? And she said, sure, that's what I wanted.
Yeah.
But anyway, the other clipping is about one of the suspects, James W. McCord, who was found in the Watergate, wanting F. Lee Bailey to represent him.
Yeah.
And the interesting thing is it says that Bailey had been asked last week by Democratic Chairman Larry O'Brien to represent the Democrats in their civil suit against the Republicans, but apparently turned down the offer.
That's interesting, that Bailey would be asked by the Democrats. Well, you see, at that level, Larry O'Brien there's no difference between Republican and Democrat at the high level. They're going to scratch each other's back. They have so much dirt on each other. And I refer to Larry O'Brien as the original body snatcher. You know, he's the one that took John Kennedy's body off the table at Parkland Hospital, and the coffin almost fell on the floor in the process. He grabbed it with Kenny O'Donnell, and the judge was there, and the coroner, and they insist on doing the autopsy of John Kennedy in Dallas. And they said, this is a plain homicide like anybody else. And he said, oh, no. And they had been in the back room with Lyndon Johnson, Kenny O'Donnell, who said, get the body to Maryland forthwith, you know, get on the plane. So they obeyed the orders, and by sending that body to back to Maryland, we never really have found out yet how many holes were in that body. And Kenny O'Donnell has been a part of a really bad team as far as John Kennedy or Robert Kennedy's assassination. He's part of the other team, you know, the thing that I wrote for you in The Realist mentions that Republicans and Democrats are both in the conspiratorial limit. In fact, I was just reading this afternoon just a little bit more of the Galen book and how Reinhard Galen, the Nazi general, came over to America after World War II and went right to the Pentagon, where he met with Alan Dulles and Arthur Schlesinger Jr., and Schlesinger was in on the bringing of Galen. Now, Schlesinger has infiltrated the McGovern camp. He was out here speaking for McGovern. He's Central Intelligence Agency. And F. Lee Bailey comes from the Central Intelligence Agency. I have documentation about his being sent from Muscle Shoals, Alabama, out to the space agencies to represent intelligence agent cases. So the Democrats are as guilty of intelligence work and using the espionage lawyer. He could take either side. It wouldn't matter because they are not going to go very far in this case unless the citizens demand the truth.
Yeah, well, one of the interesting things about it, and you mentioned before, you said that these men obviously had CIA money, and you know, I can imagine somebody listening saying, what does she mean they obviously had CIA money? But here's something connected with that that may help you to expand on it. They're talking in this clipping, also from the Washington Post, about of the five people who were arrested, only McCord, who was the highest one up, was let out. Now, the others, the judge has refused for a third time to release one defendant, Virgilio Gonzalez, because of what he said was inadequate information on the source of his $4,000 bail money.
Oh.
And then also, another man charged in the case, Eugenio Martinez, could be released on $40,000 bond as soon as information concerning various bank accounts in Miami could be verified. And then the two other defendants, Bernard Barker and Frank Sturgis, remain in the Washington, D.C. jail, awaiting an appeal on the judge's decision to deny them release until the source of their $40,000 and $50,000 bonds could be identified.
You see, Barker was the conduit of funds for the Bay of Pigs invasion, and he was holding $89,000 cash in $100 bills. 6,500 of them were in his pocket. And he won't tell where that came from, and originally it was in the Republican National Bank in Miami, and that was traced to Mexico, and that's been traced to Chile. And he says the socialist government, you know, would come down on him if he told where it comes from, which means it must be ITT money, and they don't want Chile to know how much ITT is, you know, siphoning in. The ITT plays in this case. It's going to come into this case, too. But if it's CIA money, this is the way you lose. I spoke about that last week's show, the money game, the money circle. Barker's unable to tell where he got the $89,000 cash, so he may sit in jail for a while. But as long as he's holding that cash, there can't be many provocations down in Miami for the Democrats or the Republicans, because who's going to pay them?
Uh-huh. Well, isn't there more money where that came from?
Yeah, but it's going to be spotted. See, these consecutive, the minute he was handing out money down in Miami before they were arrested, they called it CIA money. He gave one man $700 to be on the streets at the time of the convention.
Well, are you saying that, like, okay, with an elaborate plot like this, why would they have a judge like James Belson in there, who is isn't cooperating with the conspiracy. He's refusing to let these men out of jail until the source of their bail money is revealed. I mean, so just to get us off the track or what?
Well, in an elaborate plot like that, you don't choose your judge in case you're caught. You can choose your lawyer, but you can't choose your judge.
Uh-huh.
See? John Mitchell and Patrick Gray can choose.
Judges don't get assigned? Judge Hoffman didn't get assigned in
Chicago?
Oh,
yes. For the larger case, this is just on the bail thing. This isn't for the lawsuit.
Uh-huh.
See, the judge is Judge Titus has been named to handle the larger lawsuit. He's handpicked. He did the the Washington crime bill in 1970. But the immediate arrest where they're put in, that's just a lower court.
Can't be put on him?
Well, they can't pick every judge. They just took these guys off to the nearest jail, and the judge on there, they were sure they'd get out on bail because this is a very prominent man from Miami, he has prominent influence. He always bragged about his contacts in the White House, but he still has to tell where he's getting all his money. The judge is suspicious.
If you want a suspicious judge, the one that's suspicious to me automatically is Judge Charles R. Ritchie of the U.S. District Court, because he denied a request, I'm reading, by the Democratic National Committee that be allowed immediately to question the five arrested defendants. And then he explains, he says, Judge Ritchie ruled that the Democrats and their chairman, Lawrence O'Brien, quote, have failed to make the required showing that some unusual circumstances or conditions exist for the speedy questioning.
Oh, he wouldn't allow it.
He said there's nothing unusual about this.
There's that's the judge that I wrote about in the article that said he doesn't want it brought up on the case whether it's a Democratic or Republican issue, that it's not a political problem about...
Okay, then one more clipping,
yeah.
And then I'll get through these. This is a telegram that Democratic or ex-Democratic Chairman O'Brien sent to President Nixon asking him to authorize a special investigation of they still call it the alleged attempt to bug the headquarters of the Democratic National Committee. And he had previously sent a letter, which was never responded to. So now in the telegram, O'Brien says that the president had not chosen to reply to the first request, and he added that he had been informed that Mr. Nixon referred the committee for the re-election of... referred the matter to the Committee for the Re-election of the President as a political matter.
Oh, really? As a political matter? They're recognizing that it is a political matter. Yeah.
But nevertheless, now this guy, Kenneth Clausen, who's the Deputy Director of Communications for the Executive Branch, said he did not know what the President did with the first request.
Oh, it got lost. Well, I classify that under denial.
Uh-huh.
Nobody knows what happens to information that comes to them, and nobody knows the people that are being... fingered.
But then beyond the denial, he even goes further. He says also that the president has no responsibility to respond to it in the first place.
That's
so
true.
We don't know where it is, but even if we had it, we don't have to answer it.
The whole case is very quiet now, and I meet people, and I've sort of been in seclusion writing that article on the Watergate thing, and I came out after about 3 weeks, you know, like, where have you been? And I've been writing about the Watergate Hotel, and they say, well, oh, fresh my memory, what happened there?
And Watergate is just another word. You know, is that where...
Here was the top man of the Central Intelligence Agency. I suppose after Richard Helms, who's the director of the Central Intelligence Agency, James McCord has to be the second most important because he was the chief of all security of the grounds. And to collect information is one thing, but to protect the grounds is the important thing, you know, to keep it secure so that other people don't get in or out. And he was the chief of all intelligence there, and then he was assigned chief of intelligence for John Mitchell's committee to reelect Richard Nixon. And then the important job was in Miami to secure the Miami conventions. And this is where these people coming in now with the bombs and the automatic weapons and the guns will be arrested because they have to make it secure and not allow it to happen. They have to say, oh, we didn't want that to take place.
Well, what do you call them? Do you have a name for... something like the switch of the resignation of John Mitchell?
I call it the step down.
The step down?
The step down, you know. I call it the Nixon administration step down. When the people who are suspect are going to be investigated, they just step down and hope that you'll forget that they're there.
Well, they're saying in the case of John Connolly, was that a step down for a different reason?
That was manipulation.
Yeah.
I put the John Connolly step down into a... 5 weeks ago when we talked about the barbecue that John Connolly had, and I said that was the War Council. mm-hmm. with Nixon and Johnson and Connally. And after that, J. Edgar Hoover was dead. And there's a lot of evidence. I have a letter here from Justine from Germany, his newsletter, on the murder of J. Edgar Hoover. A lot of people believe that he was murdered. And this is about that car that took Hoover's body away. J. Edgar Hoover died. George Wallace was shot. John Connally has been traveling around handing messages because there's no secret memos that can go through anymore that are trusted. And Rogers has been in these different countries. The importance of Connally cannot be underestimated. And again, the Watergate thing presents a whole new picture because I was under the assumption that Nixon would be killed before the elections and that John Connally and Agnew would be the team that would be running things. And that Connally was stepping around and reappraising and lining up positions because he had a very important position in the state of Texas as far as the John Kennedy assassination goes. And
my feeling on that was always that he might not have been part of the conspiracy, but he became it after he made deals to keep quiet about which direction he was hit from by bullets himself.
As Secretary of the Navy, he had a very important part with Lee Oswald. It was just a fluke that he was hit. The marksman missed, and it hit him in his crossfire. But he was sort of like the Manchurian candidate sitting there, you know, not expecting to be uh-huh. hit. But John Connally's role was very important in the assassination of... So was Fred Korth, who was Secretary of the Navy after Connally, who then went and got the contract for the F-111 General yeah. Dynamics in Texas. There was a whole network of Texas people that were very important to Lyndon Johnson in the assassination of John Kennedy.
Well, it comes out in this little clipping, which, again, you know, I just happened to see it, and it was the Washington Post's own foreign service from yeah. Buenos Aires, and it's talking about... John Connally talking about the role of the U.S. State Department. And this Chairman Arthur Burns of the Federal Reserve Bank says, "In general, Mr. Connally has felt that the State Department has not attended to U.S. financial affairs sufficiently."
What does that mean?
Well, I don't know. Maybe it's just like pushing his image further and further. You know,
yeah.
now he's making points about the State Department. The other thing was about Mitchell, even though you call it the step down, is there another name category you have for it when it's a step down with it's only a route, it's only a front?
Because it's in the same office.
Well, yeah, in this clip it says President Nixon worked, this is July 2nd, President Nixon worked on the strategy and tactics of his reelection effort today and telephones his just resigned campaign manager, John Mitchell, to, quote, express his understanding of Mitchell's yeah. decision.
Yeah,
his understanding may have been that we'll keep asking you for
stuff.
Well,
he talks to him every day.
Uh-huh,
I mean,
yeah.
there's nothing different, but the point is that he does not head the committee, and the committee is sued for $1 million. He did give up the Justice Department as the Attorney General, which is a very important position, to become the head of the committee to reelect Richard Nixon. And that committee has this secret funding that we're going to hear a lot about, and McGovern mentioned it in his acceptance speech, and I've written about it, you know, for your articles in The Realist, on the secret funding of Richard Nixon, the clandestine agent. And John Mitchell works very closely with that firm, Robert Mullen, and the whole group that raised, they say, $10 million. We don't know how much they've raised for Richard Nixon in secret funds. I mean, the over the table, they can get a lot. But he was doing a lot of work up till April, getting that $10 million, you know, wrapped up that he refuses to tell anybody about. And I think in the lawsuit, they're going to have to disclose. I don't think he's going to be allowed to keep that secret, this truth of this money, to find out if it really, in fact, went to Chile, to Mexico, to Miami, and back to the Watergate Hotel. They're going to have to prove it didn't, say that this $89,000 didn't come from that $10 million. They're going to have to prove the source of where this came from. You see, the financing of this money circle game. But John Mitchell stepped down. Now, he still runs the FBI because we have no head of the FBI. His office is right next door. The law office is right next door at the committee to reelect. He can give the same advice, but he can't have the interviews. He isn't the figurehead. And anybody that associates with the group can be investigated. See, it is a step down because everybody is suspecting every penny that comes to them. Nixon asked this week, please don't have the lawsuit until after the elections because people will hesitate to give money. Darn right they will because they've been giving under phony friends and phony names. What if they're called in? Ralph Nader did an investigation on the funding of the Richard Nixon and claimed that $365,000 went from the Milk Group, Milk Association, to the committee to investigate Richard Nixon, then Nixon raised the prices of milk so that they could get their money back through the cost of milk. See, and give the money to the Nixon campaign.
Listen, there's a lot. The level of cynicism. I spoke to somebody who is a former gun mole. You know, the ex-girlfriend of a gangster. And she said her immediate reaction was, I wonder what the government is putting into all that milk that they're pushing it on all those commercials now.
Oh, really?
Well, that's just, it was an interesting suspicion.
Yeah.
I have to do a station break. Okay. This is KLRB in Carmel.
Listen to your book at the time of the station break, so they'll know who they're listening to. Let's talk about it a little.
Oh, well.
You have a really good book. It's funny. Tell about the book.
Oh, well, that's connected, too. I came to conspiracy out of innocence, out of false humility, because my book is called, it was originally called, going to be called, The Truth of Silly Putty, but the publisher, Putnam, the salesman there didn't know what that meant. I said, well, what the book was about, I said, why don't they read the book? But it wasn't their department. So they said, could you give us a subtitle? So I just gave them a subtitle, which was How a Satirical Editor Became a Yippie Conspirator in 10 Easy Years.
You know what? The title's so long that I'd send gifts to people, but I don't like to write out the title.
Uh-huh.
You've got to change it to Silly Putty. It takes so long to write the title, I can't even write the book to send the book order.
Well, that's the worst excuse I've ever heard.
Really? I'm short of time. We'll have to give it letters or something.
If you're really motivated, you'll do it.
I've been working too hard for the real.
I know. Anyway, that book got what was considered in the publishing industry really fine blurbs, you know, quotes from Joseph Heller, author of Catch-22, calling me a great American, from Groucho Marx saying the book is hilarious and I'm another Lenny Bruce. I mean, really fine quotes from Kurt Vonnegut Jr. and Ken Kesey and even John Lennon and Yoko Ono stuck a plug in for me.
Yeah, how long has the book been out?
Since last September. Now, what happened was, it got reviewed virtually nowhere. And I thought, at least the New York Times, since The Realist was the first underground paper, you know, you would expect the New York Times, and since it was by people in the literary world that praised it, I thought there would be a review in the Times. So I just wrote to John Leonard from the New York Times, and who's book review editor, and got back a letter from him saying, we have a review of your book in the house, but I'm afraid it's not a good one. So I said, oh, that's too bad, but I still was looking forward to it. I was curious to see how it would be criticized. And then I met Mae, and I just mentioned that in passing, and she showed me, she got out her magic files, and it was a back issue of Computer and Automation, which had an article about John Leonard, who had...
It was about the Central Intelligence Agency and the New York Times and their role, because I have many files besides a computer article on the control of Life magazine and the New York Times to keep the conspiracies from being told. They're definitely a part of the whole conspiratorial plot, their whole policy.
Well, what I learned from that was... because I wrote him a letter really trying, out of innocence, trying to understand, and I still was innocent. And then I found out indirectly from my publisher that the review of my book had been a very, very favorable one and that the writer had gotten paid for it. There's probably a name for that, the payoff, I suppose.
And then they put it on the shelf. That's called on the shelf.
There's on the shelf.
Step down and on the shelf.
Uh-huh. Yeah. That's happened a lot. I mean, Rolling Stone asked me to write a column for them once, and I wrote a thing, the first one, I said that would be of interest to our readers.
Yeah.
So I wrote a thing based on a book called Efficiency and Death, which is the participation of United States corporations in the manufacture and assembly of and loading of rocket devices into anti-personnel weapons used in Vietnam. And it was absolutely amazing to see that the companies that did it, you know, including radio stations, including everything. Everything from Remington Shavers to General Motors are all involved in that, and also Honeywell, which is the biggest, which makes a lot of photographic equipment, and also Wurlitzer and Baldwin, which ordinarily they compete with each other, and not only pianos, but because they have other brand names like Gretsch, which is a big brand name in guitars.
But they're into weapons too.
And they're also jukeboxes. Ugh. And phonographs.
Oh,
so they compete in those areas. But there's a particular rocket. I think it's the .275, a weapon used in Vietnam. That one does provides the fuel for, and the other assembles them.
I remember they play music if they drop them.
Right. It's like music to die by.
Yeah.
So they paid me for that, you know, and they never published it, that was the end of that column for Rolling Stone.
And you never heard about it.
No.
Do you ever have a contract when you do? That's sort of like that article I did for the Realist. You know, that was going to be out in March, and still isn't out. You know?
Oh, it does seem that way.
You kept the Nixon article off the shelf. Are you really for working for Nixon?
It does. I'll bet a case probably could be made for me. Right? I was a yippie that didn't get indicted in Chicago.
Yeah.
I've kept your article under.
That article about Richard Nixon that's been sitting there all these months?
Oh.
Okay.
I've been too busy writing the title of my book.
The book, do you get, now that you have some advertising and stuff, do you get some bookstores that begin to carry it?
Oh, well, you know, you hope that a demand will build up. But see, what happens is that if there's not a sale of the hardcover,
yeah,
and the softcover figure, people, it wouldn't be a good seller. Although, you know, whenever I've spoken to colleges, people keep saying, when is it going to come out in paperback?
Well, some come out
right away. Of suppression, you know, they haven't arrested me for any kind of conspiracy, but they have, since all my earnings were from the outside, they can cut down on your income and force you, you know, divert your energy.
I know.
After I testified in the Chicago conspiracy trial, at that time I was making my living doing film reviews for Cavalier magazine.
Yeah.
And after I testified, three wholesalers informed the publisher that they wouldn't distribute the magazine as long as my name appeared in it.
Oh, really?
So, you know, this is like Mort Saul on his level, you know, losing the TV show he had in Los Angeles because he was talking about the assassinations.
I was reading something of Lawrence Lipton's in Free Press today that came in L.A. Free Press, and he was talking about the third world and people getting it together and dropping out. And one of the things you have to do if you're not a part of either party or system that's equally corrupt and is that you do drop off your economic, your livelihood is cut off because there's no other way. You have to be willing to live with that. That is part of the system to squeeze out. You know, mm-hmm. If you speak honestly and say what you think, they'll read it years later and they say, oh, it's brilliant, it's wonderful, like Lenny Bruce. But at the time you're saying, everyone wants to put stones, you know, or arrows in your body, and they hate you, you know, for saying it. And it's like you go in an elevator or a drugstore now and you hear the Beatles, you know, on the music, and it really gets me mad when you think how they were screaming and yelling at the Beatles, you know.
Oh, yeah, but on the other hand, but you do what you do because you have to do it, not to get, I mean, you want recognition, but you kind of trust that you're putting pebbles in the stream and it's creating ripples. The most gratifying thing that happened to me in that area was, probably the most outrageous thing I published was the parts left out of the Kennedy book, which featured a scene in which Lyndon Johnson performed an act of necrophilia upon the corpse of Jack Kennedy on the plane that you talked about that was being kidnapping his body from...
Somebody wrote to KLRB once and referred to my program as a necrophiliac hour.
Oh, really?
So they must have remembered your article.
Well, no, I could be an independent judgment. But anyway, the point is that there are a lot of. It was written in such a way that a lot of people believe that to be literally true. And one of the people who believed it to be literally true was Daniel Ellsberg.
Oh, really?
And that was in 1967. Uh-huh. Now, he didn't immediately come out and change his position, change his direction. But that was one of the inputs. You know, in order for him to have believed that, he had to believe that Lyndon Johnson was crazy. Yeah. I mean, I guess that's a fair assumption, unless you're practicing necrophiliac and you think that's a perfectly normal activity.
Otherwise.
You can even remain faithful to one corpse. You know, none of this promiscuous necrophilia. So, go steady.
All the way to Washington.
Right. So the fact that he believed it meant that in 67 he thought that the president of his country that he was working for was crazy, that was directing the policies of Vietnam that
he was
working for.
He was reading the policies, so there was double reason to believe it.
Yeah, right. But that was one of the inputs that affected his consciousness that in the end... caused him to be part of what you and I both hope for is an epidemic of conscience. I mean, that's the thing that gives me hope. Dick Gregory tells me the CIA men come to him and give him information. Now that they hear this, we'll give him misinformation. But he says because they see the way things are going. As you've said on this program, I've heard you say that these kind of conspiracies are based on are done on a need-to-know basis. And as people began to put pieces of this jigsaw puzzle together, they can see this these connections.
And I hope that they will surface. Incidentally, since the show last week and I talked about Louis Tackwood and in reference to the Watergate affair, Louis Tackwood was picked up by the L.A. Police Department and beat very badly, and he's in jail down there. I don't know anything about the charges. I was supposed to get a call over the weekend and see what was happening. And he was one of the courageous people that worked 9 years at the police department and surfaced because Ellsberg surfaced. And then Larry Shearer surfaced after that and talked about the Treasury Department plan to kill Chavez and Eldridge Cleaver. And more people now are speaking up. The latest man to surface was a fellow in New York City, the trial of the Harlem Four. They've had three trials and been acquitted, and the judge said you're going to do a fourth. And their chief witness came out this week in the New York Times and said, I lied every time through the trial to try to get those men convicted, that I was afraid of the police department, that they would kill me and threaten me. And I think that more people that speak up and hear about these things that are a part of these crimes and have a conscience, because I think we're going into an age of conscience. And I hope that people that have been sitting back on the side and have been part of these crimes will speak up. I really hope they will.
Well, yeah, sometimes, as I said earlier, you know, people do through their own filters. So it kind of stunned me a little bit when I moved. The first demonstration in San Francisco that I saw was last year when they had when labor finally got involved. But they had signs that said, the Vietnamese never froze my wages. You know, so they weren't doing it on any particularly moral level, really, but at least they were getting in.
But the people that have been witness to a crime, I noticed that Ellsberg had an ad raising money for his defense that came out. And one of the things he mentioned, speaking about Ellsberg, was that he was arguing about the executive branch of the government being secretive and that they had to come down on him and make a treason trial at this time, because I'm reading in quotes, he said, the executive branch of government is afraid that if these men do not suffer for their act, other government servants may also follow their conscience. Oh, this is Ellsberg's attorney or chairman for the fund, Stanley Scheinbaum, raising money for Ellsberg and Russo. He said, they are afraid that other government servants may follow their conscience and reveal not military secrets, but political secrets, information improperly withheld from Congress and the American people.
Oh, it happens. This is how, you know, I'm sure you've, have you heard over the past 4 years, you would have figured it out, but the rumor or the story about the RAND Corporation having an assignment from the administration to figure out the ramifications of there not being national elections in 1972?
Oh, yeah, I have that in my files.
Oh, well,
my filing cabinet.
All right, well, I got that story originally in, I guess it was 69, right after Woodstock.
Did that break in the Realist?
Huh? No, I was afraid.
Really?
That
why?
I was going to get killed. So I just broke it at every possible thing. There was a meeting in New Mexico of the people who had put on Woodstock. And there were people there from Rolling Stone, which never carried it, but Look magazine and excuse me, and underground papers.
Yeah,
I started talking about it there. I started talking about it on radio in New York. And John Mitchell once said something like, "Whoever started this rumor is going to get punished." Well, I now admit it publicly, but it wasn't. But it wasn't a rumor.
Okay,
it was. It was a thing that had been told to me by one of the people that you're talking about who had
access to the information and
was struck by conscience.
Okay, let's say right at this moment that John Mitchell's going to get punished now for some of the things he's done.
Yes,
there's a little justice in this world.
The category for that is returning karma.
Returning karma. Oh, if that's true, there's going to be a lot of karma going around. But the thing is that there are men at RAND that know a lot. There's a people at the Pentagon, and I hope there's just not enough of them. And a lot of people have said to me, there couldn't be a conspiracy in Dallas to kill John Kennedy because there's so many people involved that somebody would have talked. A lot of people have talked, but nobody listens. It's like Martha Mitchell saying, they gave me a shot, or had stitches on my finger, I'm a prisoner. She's talking. People just don't want to hear what she's saying because then they become involved themselves and they're too lazy.
Well, I think it's also a kind of American chauvinism you know, people can accept the idea that the CIA and the Rand Corporation could systematically set up a dictatorship in Greece and in Saigon, but not here. And but, you know, history, like Mid-Century Journey by William Shira, has a points out how the entire French press was bought.
Well, one of the warning signals I really worry about, because I worry about McGovern staying alive and what's going to happen, you know, for a while. One of the bad signals was when Thu came out yesterday and said, we don't take McGovern seriously, and neither does Ellsworth Bunger, you know, the team down there. They don't take this seriously at all, the whole election. Well, when you think how that man could manipulate through so many assassinations and prison terms for his opponents and do that phony rig thing, then not taking McGovern seriously means this is a phase that will be taken care of. I think that's that description of the Miami nomination worries me.
Well, it also could mean that how else could it respond to somebody who's called him a corrupt dictatorship?
There is an article.
He has to say, I don't take it seriously.
One of the reasons, you know, you talk about Conley traveling around all these different countries and what he's doing at this time. The foreign press, there was an article today, did you see it? All the different countries' their reaction to McGovern's nomination. And it said the foreign press has been so saturated with Nixon's trip and Nixon's, you know, traveling around and his great relationships that they don't, not one of the countries they quote would take McGovern seriously, that they felt comfortable with what Nixon was doing. And I'm sure the Conley must be threatening a loss of dollars if their people didn't give some overt support to Nixon, because they're just shaking. I was reading an article about the Swedish economy and all the different countries in Europe would have the dollar. It was in the paper last night. All the different countries are shaking. And that's a Nixon trick, like really getting them nervous about what would happen if they got in. Like, I control the dollar, the European money, and the what they're doing to the pound, and in France, Germany, England, Italy, and even Switzerland. Switzerland said, now, if you want to put money in the bank, you're going to pay us 8% interest rate. The dollar is just really played around with in Europe, and this is going to continue. Conley's the money man. It's going to continue till November as a threat. Like he said, to the Jewish vote. I have an article from the New York Times that if he doesn't get the Jewish vote, he, after the election, he will ask that they give back the land they got in the Six-Day War and make Palestine an open city. I mean, that is the wheeling-dealing Nixon, the most awful, flagrant bargaining. I can't imagine his putting his cards out that open. Did you read that article? I was really...
It's like a... How can you call him an Indian giver without insulting the Indians?
that's nasty to say that.
You said you wanted to read something from an article that was published in the Realist back in June 1966. But let me give the background of that.
Yes.
It's by Eric Norden, and Norden wrote an article for me on the assassination of Malcolm X. And the reason he did that, he was inspired. There was a guy named Art Steuer, who was the press representative for Dick Gregory. And let me tell you a brief little story about that. When Gregory was in Watts, you know, and he got shot in the leg trying to cool things down, and he didn't want to call the paper himself, so he called Art Steuer in New York, told him the details, and Art called the L.A. Times and said he was in the phone booth in the middle of Watts and gave him all the details.
Oh, wow.
So it became a front-page story, Dick Gregory hurt in Watts riot, and it was done by way of, you know, by 3,000 miles. Anyway, Steuer wrote an article on the conspiracy theory that he figured out. He figured that Adlai Stevenson was assassinated.
Oh, yes, definitely.
And he wrote an article for The Realist. Well, it's easy for you to say, oh, yes, definitely.
Definitely. There's a chapter coming out of the festival.
You mean you could just make a tally sheet on the wall.
Yes, of course. That's my wallpaper.
But Eric Norden saw the article and thought it was satirical. You know, he said, now, wait, well, I'm going to write about a real conspiracy, the assassination of Malcolm X and the cooperation of the New York Police Department with the CIA. So he wrote that, and then in February of 1966, he wrote an article in Liberation magazine called American Atrocities in Vietnam. And like you, I was still gung-ho then on sending out stuff. I had copies of the reprints of that article sent to every single congressman and senator and the president.
The atrocities, yeah. And it was so new to us. Yeah.
Right. That was in February of 66. The only one who responded was Bobby Kennedy,
oh, really?
By the way. You know, it was just a formal thank you letter, but at least, you know...
He was still alive.
It was a buzz, if nothing else. So Eric Norden had a piece he wanted me to publish called... he called it The Tender Tyranny of American Liberals. And I printed it as a supplement to an issue to maintain.
I ordered a whole bunch of them.
Uh-huh.
That was in 66. I just met Paul in 72, but I ordered a whole bunch of those. I mail them out to everybody, the supplement that you
have. Yeah, well, it surprised me in a way that it got the response. Mort Saul read some of it on his TV
show.
So
far out, yeah.
And I guess I took it for granted, you know, because I had met so many phony liberals. But I thought that probably there are a lot of people who haven't seen this kind of criticism of liberals in the publication that is thought of as left of center.
That's right.
So what are the parts that...
Well, the parts I sent for it, because this was in 1966, and it was called The Tender Tyranny of American Liberals, and my copies turned almost yellow. It's so old. It's 66 seems like a long time, Paul. But it goes into the political and spiritual bankruptcy of contemporary liberalism. That is, he said, just another sign of evidence of American decadence. And alongside of this article was one by Tom Braden I brought in from June 72, talking about the alienation of American people, the rootless, valueless society without goals. And he compared America in 1972, this is Tom Braden in June 72, as since the death of John Kennedy in 1963, that the country had lost all its norms and that something was wrong, that we're in a spiritual crisis in 72. So I go back to the Realist in 66, which is talking about that crisis, you know, and he said the liberals have functioned both as imperialism's Kiplings, like Schlesinger, Burns, and Lerner, and they sold horror on the intellectual marketplace with the elan of Madison Avenue. Then the article goes into liberals do not possess the virtue of most fanatics, which is loyalty. The grief of the libs at the loss of the young champion, that was John Kennedy, did not extend to a dedication to uncover the truth about his death. As soon as the indicators pointed not to a lone assassin, but a well-organized conspiracy within agencies of the federal government, including the FBI and the CIA, the liberals looked the other way. JFK could be mourned, but not avenged. Too many apple carts would be upset in the process. He said at the upper level of the liberal establishment, there was a desperate effort, conscience and cynical, to cover up all traces of the conspiracy and reassure the American people that all was still the best in the best of all possible worlds. And even before Kennedy's corpse had cooled, leading libs assured us that the assassination was nothing more sinister than the act of a lone lunatic and the alleged murderer's own rub-out in the Dallas jail, just a chance conversion on the scene of another madman, Jack Ruby. Then he referred to Earl Warren, the most egregious judicial fraud in recent history.
Egregious,
is that what it is? Was trotted out to provide a convenient liberal fig leaf for the biggest cover-up since the investigation of Lincoln's murder. And within a year, his commission of right-wing political hacks, segregationist senators, and princes of industry presented the public with a safe, prophylactic version of the assassination the libs desired. The Warren Commission report itself, an incredible melange of lies, half-truths, omissions, evasions, and distortions, is the ultimate testament to a contemporary liberalism, fully deserving the place alongside the Reichstag trial in the annals of political-judicial mythology. Well, this is what you published in the Realist in 66, and that's about what it was and where it was. And you really had a lot of courage, because I take 8 papers a day, I was taking 60 magazines a month, and 8 papers a day, and going through everything from American Opinion to the Wallace paper I take, and right, left, and middle. And this article that you printed in The Realist was the most honest description of the people who let down Kennedy, who were pretending they wanted the country to be better. And then Tom Braden of the CIA, who travels along with Salinger and McGovern and all the liberals, cries now that the country is morally bankrupt. And yet his whole organization was in on the thing.
Well, except, you know... To be devil's advocate about myself, when I first moved to California, I went on a camping trip with some friends up in the Sierras and saw Gary Snyder, the poet, and he was talking about this guru who had said something like, "If the possibilities are infinite, that means in all directions."
Yeah.
You know, that means if the possibilities for hope are infinite, that means the possibilities for despair also. You know, or for compassion than the possibilities for sadism, I suppose.
Yeah.
And I'm in the middle of reading a book now called Neither to Laugh Nor to Weep, and it's a memoir of the Armenian genocide in which, for 27 years, it started in 1895, there were 2 million deaths, and another couple of million people were figuratively and often literally driven into the sea before Turkey had solved its Armenian problem.
Like Burundi now, yeah.
So, and there's a comment here that his warning essentially is that when governments forget that they are dealing with human beings, not abstract problems, the results can be horribly inhuman. So, why do you think, why do you, I mean, one would suspect that somebody with all your knowledge would be filled with despair rather than have any sense of hope. Now, in that kind of historical perspective, you know, where violence is thought of as part of the human condition, you know, and the Book of Job is supposed to be eternal in that context, you know, how come you still have hope?
I'm very optimistic. In fact, somebody was over, I forget it was this week, and said, you're always so optimistic, you know, about what you do, your enthusiasm. It was a researcher. I talked on the phone long distance somebody, and they said, you're always so optimistic, you know, where they're really always down. Because, well, first of all, I don't believe in original sin. I don't believe that people are born evil or bad, and I think that's a heavy trip, the Judeo-Christian, the Christian.
I'm not one or the other. I'm talking about yin-yang.
Well, I have my own.
I'm talking about you can't have the concept of goodness without the concept of badness to be relative to.
Well, I think the badness is a question of interpretation and perversion, that there's no such thing as being born bad, and that people are born good. And if you get the climate right for them to nurture their goodness, the goodness is stronger than the bad. I think the bad is a heavy trip put on. I don't think it's born in you. And I think you have a climate, when you have a climate or condition where the real you unfolds, the real you will be peace-loving. I did this, you know, like with my own children. I had certain goals that I wanted. You know, I had five children, and I said, how do you make them not destructive or loving or accepting? In this world, I'll have this will be my own clinic, my own nursery or greenhouse of my own children. And by not preaching or so forth, can I create people that are decent human beings? And if that works, the systems I use, I'd write about someday. And maybe other people will be able to use those too. And they've grown up. The youngest is 10 now. The others are adults. And I think they're decent human beings. They don't even want to hit a fly in the house. And it's not because I've said, oh, don't hit flies. It's just built in. The motors are built in. And I think it's consideration when they're little, and the decency that's in a human being, if you treat them decently, the climate is there. And all of this violence, the provocateurs, the killings, are put-ons. The religion, you talked about religious wars, the fact that Goebbels was into religious thing and still was sadistic. Well, what is the Inquisition or the Crusades?
No, but I didn't say religion. I said Gurdjieff. Because there are a lot of people who think
But the mystical, the organized religions we have today, the worst radicals, the extremists, right wing, are the religious fanatics. You know, they take their religion and then go out and kill.
Oh, I think it has to do with organized religion. The fact that it's organized is therefore a means of control.
Yeah. Well, I'm optimistic every day because I feel that the good is going to take over the bad, that the bad is just a phase that can't go on, and no matter how many weapons and devices they have for following or data banks or control, that as soon as people understand their own value as human beings, like, I don't have more information, I'm not smarter than somebody else, they just haven't brought out their own potential.
You do have more information.
Well, I have information, but they have the potential to have that same information. I spent the evening last night with somebody who was brought up, kicked around in our society, who is black, who is fought in the streets with guns and things. And I tried, you know, to say, look, tools and information is so much better than weapons. And let's pull our heads and all work together and use the brains that they don't think you're supposed to have and you've got. And we'll all make it together. We're all one family. It's a family of man. And I'm optimistic that that message is going to spread because that's the truth. And truth lives, and their lies, and the lies of hatred or racism or people being different from each other is a lie.
Oh, yeah, it's not
and in time.
It's just another way of expressing, I guess, what Huey Newton said. The quote is, the spirit of the people is greater than the man's technology.
Absolutely, and today with the radio and cassette and there's few programs like this, but we're here. And people make tapes, and they spread them information all over the country, like WBAI New York. And there's a lot of good stations in San Francisco, L.A., and Underground Press, and things that you put out in the Realist, like this thing that's been going, you've been there in 13 years. You print some truths, and the Realist is still living. Look Magazine folds up, and the Realist is still going. I mean, it's just one of those things. You tell them the truth, and it's small, but it spreads. I mean, a lot of people, you're in the California area, and I won't ever mention your name, people are really surprised that you're out here. Your name is well known. They all know you, and the truth lives. No one is going to remember we even owned the Look magazine. See, I mean, that's just come and going because it was half lies, half truth. And if you just keep giving them what you really
think. Well, I'm half lies, half truth, but I admit it.
No, but you're
see, I just want everybody to be as suspicious of the mass media as they are of me.
You're not talking down to people like they're idiots. You're trying to tell them with a little tongue-in-cheek some of the sad things, some of the good things, and let them play with their gray matter and brains, which isn't what the media want.
Well, I think in that sense, because you and I are both editors in a sense, you know, you edit the material that you come in contact with. And I think that the condescension factor is what's lacking in us, I hope.
Yeah.
Because every editor I've ever known always talks about us and them. You know, but I'm one of them. And I just want to share the stuff that turns me on. That's what you want.
Well, listen, thanks for coming to visit. I had a
we could have another
maybe next
4
Saturday.
Hours of mutual compliments. When I discovered you.
Okay.
You were just
a nothing.
And it's an incipient necrophiliac.
Okay.
This is KLRB in Carmel, and this is Paul Krassner, and I've been talking to Mae Brussell, and she'll be back again next Saturday at 4:00.
Thank you for coming.
To say goodbye to Mae Brussell and Paul Krassner and continue on with music here. This is KLRB FM in Carmel.